Good evening, everybody. I think there is a very large group of people. Most of them are very distinguished members of the profession and the society. So without individually addressing all of you, I will simply say thank you for being here. This is a nationally important gathering. Whether you are a senior member of the parliament or whether you are a secretary of the government department, or whether you are a young engineer, or whether you are a public member, because this is a public lecture, public discussion, I welcome you all. My name is Arjuna Manamperi. I am the chairman of the Mechanical Engineers Sectional Committee of Institution of Engineers Sri Lanka. The proceedings for the day goes like this. Now, I'm going to, instead of setting the table, I'm going to set the train, right? There's a phrase called setting the table. Instead of doing that, I'm going to set the train. The way this is going to work out is I will take about 10 minutes of my time, your time, to explain and set the table, or so rather set the train, to understand where things have been in the past. Then we have four distinguished members as panel members, and I will invite one at a time to give a certain portion of the story. And then we will open up, after about 35 to 40 minutes, we will open up for discussions, open discussions. That's basically how it's going to be done. So let me start. One other thing I would like to say to all of you, so there are some new faces I see here. This discussion is now being recorded and live streamed throughout the world. Any one of our ISL members living any part of the world can see this today, right now. And also, this will be recorded digitally and it will be available on ISL YouTube channel for anyone to view. We have been doing this for the last 3 years. There are a lot of lectures that anyone wishes to go and see. So with that, let me proceed with my part of the initial discussion. Now, this is a year 2015 Global Competitiveness Report, 2014-2015. These are the top 10 countries in the world which has great infrastructure. Now the reason I put this slide up is if you take the first two, one, number one and two, and number five, the thing about these three countries is trains. They have fantastic train systems that most of you know. I'm sure you know that Hong Kong has a great train system and Singapore does. And then of course Switzerland is famous for many, many decades having great train systems. So trains are part of a good infrastructure. The second point to set the table or set the train, essentially this is the graphical representation of the story between diesel locomotives, diesel railways and electric railways. In a nutshell, electric trains have a high cost of initial investment when you want to start it compared to the diesel engines. Diesel trains, but as time progresses, at certain point, electric trains become more economically viable. That depends on the number of times, the frequencies at which a service is being provided. So no wonder Hong Kong and particularly Singapore and any other large megapolis or a metropolis has electrical railways. You will hear a lot of, from our panel members, a lot of analysis. This is, I don't expect you to read all of it, but when you do a cost-benefit analysis for a railway electrification system, these are the key points. We look at community benefits, we look at road use and environmental benefits, rail users benefits, railway financial benefits. Because you will notice that it is not the financial returns that matters. It is also the economic internal rate of returns matters when you do these kind of projects for a given country. So this is a model from a well-known study done, I think early 2000s, in Egypt. This was an electric railway system between Cairo and Alexandria. You may not be able to read all of these things, but the key point I want to highlight here is that there is a financial internal rate of return here. Financial internal rate of return is 9.2, which is not very lucrative. That's not a big deal. Getting 9.2 financial rate of return is not a big deal in a project. Most people will not invest. But if you look at the economic rate of return is 16.9. That's significant. That's the point I want to raise. Because when we go through this process, you need to understand it's not just about the financial internal rate of return, but also the economical internal rate of return. That's what matters. Now the story. My job here is to prepare you for the rest of the discussion. And I thank my colleague, Dr. Tilak Sembalapitiya, for giving me the necessary material for this. My job is to deliver it to you. Now there is a project. That's called Railway Electrification and Modernization Project in Sri Lanka, REMP, REM. This is well known. This is the story. Today, we spend about 1 billion rupees per day providing mobility within Colombo municipality regions. Roads, other utilities, other services, 1 billion rupees a day. However, within the same region, total passenger kilometers by public transport is less than 25%. In other words, if you take the buses, the train, and any other form of public transport, only 25% is used for utilizing the infrastructure that we have. Another way to look at it, very little. Because Colombo right now have something like 4.5 to 5 million people, I believe. And with the megapolis plans, if they work out, they plan to make it 8 million or more within the next 5 years. So there will be a lot of people here. So if you have this picture, that's not going to work out. So obviously we have a problem on our way. It's already there. And out of these public transports, that 25% of that, less than 10% is railway, which is really, really pathetic. But there's another issue with our railway systems. Whatever we have, our average speed is about 29 to 30 kilometers per hour. That's the highest speed that we can, average speed that we can achieve. Most trains run within this range, and that's pretty slow compared to most modern metropolises. So that's the background. Very little utilization of our infrastructure for public transport. Trains play a very little role in all this. Now, Railway, Sri Lanka Railway celebrated 150th year about 2 years ago. Am I right, Priyat? 2 years ago. 150 years of railway in Sri Lanka, that was 2 years ago. 60 years after that, that is 1924, if I do the mathematics right, maybe around that. 1924, Sri Lanka started talking about electrifying railways. So this is not a new story. This is a 90-year-old story. So this is not a new thing. That's an important thing to remember. So still we have not done it. So let me emphasize that language, sentence. We have still not done it. There was a very important study done by this Institution of Engineers Sri Lanka in 2008. They conducted a study with technical support from Institute of Engineers India, trying to figure out how can we really take this off. That means how can we go as a nation to use electric railways, replacing some of the diesel railways that we have. That study, as early as 2008, said the ideal stretch for a pilot project would be between Veyangoda and Panagoda. That's what that study said. The reason being, 44% of the passengers who travel using trains use that particular stretch. They also found out even then that electrical trains, that slide that I put out, I said that electrical trains will be cheaper to run when you run it for a period of time, and than the diesel engines. So that's a cost benefit. There was a joint cabinet memorandum soon after that study, 28th of May 2015, not soon after that, after 2008, leading up to 2015, hive of activity started taking place. After the elections, This is 28 May 2015, so that was after the presidential election. They have a hive of activities. There were four things that they were concentrating through this memorandum. The memorandum said, set the priority for electrification. Set the priority, number one, for Colombo Urban Railway services. Set the priority, which one first, which one second, which one third. Second, have a steering committee to study the proposal given by ISL. Detailed study of it so that we can begin to think of how to execute it, how to fund it, and etc. The third element was, how do we secure capital and technical expertise if needed to carry those priorities? Then, of course, set up project management unit and get on with the work. This was in May of 2015. Where are we with this cabinet memorandum status? The priority to electrify railway has been accepted. You know, the biggest projects that is going to be launched in the near future is the megapolis and the western region megapolis. Even that, ministry has accepted railway electrification as the main development effort in this country, in the infrastructure development effort in this country in the next 5 years. So the priority has been set according to the memorandum. The steering committee was appointed and they had three meetings up to now. So May, you have the memorandum, a steering committee was appointed and they had three meetings to deliberate. There was a special meeting with Asian Development Bank, which is a funding organization, to discuss about funding as well. Now, the first point, the priority to electrify railway, comes out in this particular paragraph. This was 2 or 3 days ago stated by megapolis project leader Mr. Lakshman Jayasekara. You can read it. He says, I was at a planning session 2 days ago or 3 days ago, I can't remember exactly. I was at a different planning session and Mr. Jayasekara was there. The first 5 years they will do most of the work, that's their plan. The funding is there. And Mr. Jayasekara says 70% of that stuff belongs to transport sector. That's what he says. So megapolis first 5 years is essentially on, more or less it's all about transport. So everything lines well. This is the steering committee that was created. I will not go one by one, but if you look at it, you can clearly see all the right stakeholders are there. Of course, the Department of Sri Lanka Railway is there, but Ceylon Electricity Board, LECO, IESL, the people who started the report, National Planning Department, all these things are there. So it's a comprehensive steering committee, not a one-man show. These are already in place. Then the third element was secure capital. This is the status of it. The financial assistance to carry out Panaduru Bayanguda, am I right? Tilak, yeah. Sector, the ADB has in principle agreed to allocate funds in this fashion. This is an early determination. So the funds are there. So the strategy is in place, priority is in place, steering committee is in place, funding is in place. The fourth element is to create a project management unit and carry this out. The PMO has been created, one of your panel members, engineer Priya De Silva, is the project director on an interim basis currently, and he will talk about this, and the rest of the officers are there. They have done some observations within the stretch that we are talking about. This is ongoing. So this is the fourth area. Here lies the issue. It is when you come to that fourth area, that is to get this thing going. The strategy is in place, priority is in place, funding is in place. Or very much so, looks like that. If we have to use it, we have to get serious about it. But when it comes to the project management execution in a more serious manner, that is where we have a little hold up. So the panel today, the four eminent people who will talk about this, who have hands-on experience in this subject matter, have suggested that to appoint a ministerial committee to guide and oversee the implementation of the project. It's important. This is a national project. Electrification of railway is a big deal. Managing our transport, public transport, is the new battle that we fight along the lines of exports and education. Expand the existing steering committee. Bring in more stakeholders. Establish a project management unit. There is a one, but make it formal under the Ministry of Internal Transport. The PMU that has been set up for the past few months, make it very, very formal and set it under the Ministry of Internal Transport. And then allocate the sums of money from Asian Development Bank that has been in principle agreed to in a systematic manner. And if you look at that date, the 1st of April, fully operational by 1st of April. What month is this? May. There is some work going on. The government of Sri Lanka, our government is paying attention to this. But today's discussion is all about this. Today's discussion is to reinforce that electrification of railway is a national priority. It has been understood. It has been prioritized. It has been accepted at the government level and at the professional level. Temporary arrangements have been made. So the goal is now to make it serious, create the necessary operational environment and get this going. So that is, ladies and gentlemen, is the status quo. Now, what I will do, I will take the seat here as the moderator. I'll be your moderator today, and I will invite one panel member at a time to give a synopsis of his or her area to further reinforce what I just said. Okay? So let me take my seat and begin that process. And then you will get a chance to ask questions and discuss.
So I'm going to take this, right? So my first invited me to the stage will be Engineer Pierre Silva, who is a former general manager of Sri Lanka Railway, well-known person. His railway runs in his family. His father was a general manager. I would call him even a more of an historian. But he was also our past president at Institution of Engineers Sri Lanka a few years ago. Pierre will give you the historical side of the picture.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are highly encouraged with your presence in numbers today. And let me also welcome our Honorable MP, Engineer Geetanjana Gunawardana, who is in the audience. And I am asked to speak for 5 minutes only, but let me just tell in brief.
Either way, whatever comes. You press this one to move forward the slide.
All right. I use this way forward in a different, little bit of different concept. Electrification, modernization is the way forward for the railway. Why? That is, railways actually burning 30 million liters of diesel for a year, and they run about 10,000 train kilometers. So with the electrification, this can be reduced significantly, maybe 50%, because the suburban service is about, goes about 5 to 6 million kilometers. Then also to provide a comfortable, reliable service to passengers. also they can also increase the modal share of passengers. So that is why electrification is a must. If I just let you have a brief history, as Arjuna mentioned, it's in 1924 that late engineer D.J. Vibrasen, this auditorium is named after him. He was the father, we call it father of hydropower. He is the one who first mooted railway electrification. Then in 1960, tenure of legendary GMR, late engineer V.D. Rampada, I wonder whether he was having an idea of leapfrogging from steam to electrification, electric locos. But yet then I know for certain that he appointed a committee of senior railway officials, including Mr. Shanmugaraja, who was operating superintendent at that time, and Mr. P. Rajagopal, and my late father, Engineer Ernest Silva, to form a committee and recommend electrification of railways. And then at the same time, there was a proposal by French that was about in 1960s, late 60s, to electrify the entire network, that is Kalambu Nigambo, Kalambu Veyangoda, and Kalambu Kalutara. At that time, it cost only 18 million Sri Lanka rupees. 18 million Sri Lanka rupees, because I know that as a school going boy, because my father used to come and tell me at home it is only 18 million rupees. So Mr. Rampal, although he was a steam expert on, sorry, on steam and diesels, he advocated on electrification of railways. Then there was there were many other proposals up to 1990 from Japanese, Romanian, Korean and Swedish. And in 1999, we in the IESL recommended to the Minister of Transport and to the General Manager at that time, Mr. Beragama, to do this electrification locally. That is to utilize our resources and of course to get some materials down from India and do the electrification. Now, why we told that is that I can, some of you all could remember during Kambudavas in 1990 or late 1980s at Kaburupitiya and at Buttala, we ran two electric trains, purely electric trains. I wonder whether anybody can remember, for a stretch of about 1 kilometer inside the Kambudava premises. So we had the capacity. We had the capacity to identify locally. Then in 2008, we got a proposal done, including our engineers, and one Mr. Ray from India came under the when Mr. Engineer Ranjit Gunawardana was the president of IESL. He took a great stand in doing that. And then when we went and submitted it to the Minister of Transport. At the same time, a Chinese proposal was also in hand, and they told that they will study and let us know, but nothing materialized again. Now, what are the advantages of electrification? Now, you will know exactly the saving of foreign exchange with reduction of import of fuel. Then, environment pollution is almost nil, and the cleanliness is there, unlike diesel. The cleanliness is there, diesel suit is not there, no moving parts, and hence drastic reduction in maintenance. And long operational life of locomotives because of less moving parts. Now at the moment you will know railway stocks 80,000 different kind of spares for overhauls of diesel locomotives and 15,000 different kind of spares for recruitment for recurrent maintenance, daily maintenance. So all that can be reduced if we can go for electrification. Then also fast acceleration and fast deceleration. This means reduce time in between stations. Longer trains and high number of passengers. Less noisy, no vibration, and quieter on the long term. Smoother train travel with air conditioning facilities. All that is comfort on the side of comfort for the passengers. Then regenerative power back to the grid on braking. Then capital expenditure on rolling stock is less than counterpart diesel sets. Of course, when you take the entire thing into account, of course, there's capital cost is going to be rather high because you have to have the catenaries and various things and other modifications, modernizations. So because that percentage may be high, but when you take the counter with the rolling stock only, the price of rolling stock will be much less than diesel locomotive. Then modernization, the maximum benefit of now modernization has to be done to maximize the benefit of electrification. If you just don't do electrification, just do electrification on its own without modernization, you can't get the benefit. Now, what are these modernization? Now, initially, track should be upgraded to get a speed of 100 kilometers power. Then the signaling system should be insulated from any interference from the power and upgraded to cater for train to travel at 2 minute headway. Now, at the moment, our signaling system caters for 3 minute headway, but we never run at 3 minute headway. We run during peak hours about 5 minute headway. But if you are having a system like this, definitely you have to run at 2 minute headway to take the passengers through. Then parking at stations. Now we have to cater for the car passengers who would like to come in cars from home, park at stations, get into the train and get into an air conditioned compartment and get to office. Now therefore parking at stations will have to be improved and it should be safeguarded parking. Parking will be safe. Then circulating areas at stations to be enlarged. When you expect more people to travel by train, definitely circulating areas in stations had to be enlarged. Then automatic ticketing and e-ticketing facilities. Now if you represent ticketing facilities at stations, you know, go in a queue, get the ticket from station master, it takes a long time. There must be individual ticketing machines and platforms like in other countries, and you should be able to purchase your ticket after putting money or coins and get the ticket. And also same time, you should be able to revalidate your ticket or whatever you have by recharging it, and you should be able to travel back there. Then present information systems and display both at stations and on board of trains. So they will give correct information and so forth, and you don't have to ask people and waste time like that. Then gate system for faster exit and entry at stations. You put the ticket, you get out of the station, when you come in you put the ticket and then the ticket will come from the lane, you take the ticket and go. Same time these gates will record the number of people who have entered the station and exited the station on a day. So those statistics are also available. Then platforms will be raised to floor level of carriages for easy entry and exit from train, thus reducing stopping time at station. Most of the trains get delayed. They start at the correct time now, but they get delayed en route because, especially during peak hours, because there's a rush in getting in and getting out of the train. And therefore, the train normally has to stop about 30 seconds, but in most of the suburban stations, it stops for about 1 minute. My last slide, safety consideration. Tracks to be fenced right through and designated level crossing to be maintained at places for public requirements such as access to beach, restaurants and fisherfolk. This is very important because you would have noticed that recently two young children got knocked out by a train at the hill. So those 6 precautions will have to be taken. Then at existing level crossings, warner boards to be placed on either side of to warn drivers of motor vehicles of the overhead catenary. This also you would notice that without such water boats, a container went and knocked a bridge at carrier. So supposing it knocks the catenary, people will get electrocuted. Therefore the proper water boats that will be placed on either side of the level crossing. Then automatic closure of doors of trains. platforms will be marked to indicate where the doors of trains will be when it comes to a halt, when it comes to halt, so that that mad dust will not be there. People will wait where the door is, they'll queue up, and when after people get down, other people will get in. So by which the train should be able to start early, they will not be required to stop more than about 25 seconds, 30 seconds at the station. Then platforms will be marked to indicate safety clearances from edge of platform. Now, especially when trains are express through stations, there's a sometimes the you know due to the air pressure, there's a tendency for the people in the platform to get sucked in between the carriages. So therefore, they have to stay so many feet or so many meters away from the platform edge. That is what is required, because actually they have put platforms in bark to indicate safety clearances from edge of platform. Then overhead structures, bridges where catenary is passing under, to be insulated. So those are the few safety considerations that have to be taken. So my presentation is over. At question time, I am prepared to answer any questions.
Yeah, the right hand, that's okay. Our next speaker is going to be someone who is very known. That will be Dr. Sunaksinath at Simla Media. And he will give a comprehensive analysis of electrification of railway.
I guess there are a lot of members and guests waiting at the door
to get in. There's a rush at the door.
We have a very limited number of seats around here.
Yeah,
maybe.
I think that if rather than staying back, if you come through the center section and get to the sides, that's what you could do at this point.
At least there are three seats here.
There are three seats here, and also you can open both those seats. Right.
Yeah, then there will be more seats.
There are four seats available here, one more seat there.
Members of Parliament, fellow members of the institution, our guests, ladies and gentlemen. The Railway Electrification and Modernization Project has never been close to implementation as it is today. The project is ready to go. The project is financed and it has the support of the Institution of Engineers and more than that, the entire government. If we look at it from the government's accelerated development policy, to my knowledge, this is the only project for which there is money. For all other projects, money is yet to be found. So therefore, I believe, based on the benefits that I will also describe, as well as given the fact that the project has been delayed since 1924, there is no other project that will bring the benefits to the community at large than this project. Let me move on. 400,000 people per day travel like this. So you see on the left hand side. If you look at the airport expressway, which is adjacent to the railway track in Hunupitiya area, 400,000 on the track and probably 20,000 on the airport expressway. That's about all. So the railways, which many of us say are inefficient, dilapidated, not running on time, but people are using it. But they deserve to travel in one of those on the right hand side. Why? Because these people are contributing to our economy. If all of them also buy that motorcycle and the small car and get onto the road, none of us, the majority of whom are using cars, would not be able to get around at all. So whenever you see a train like that, at least silently tell those people thank you for going by train. Hundreds of thousands also travel like that, in traffic jams, in unsafe conditions. They too can travel on the train because it saves energy, the time, it's environment friendly, safer, and it gives you the peace of mind. So by now, from what you have heard, I am sure you will feel like leaving your car next time and getting onto one of those. But be patient until 2020. So of course, railway electrification has to be done. How? Where to start? Where to begin? A map of Sri Lanka railways indicating various sectors, various lines. So, as you heard, the Institution of Engineers has conducted many studies, and the most recent one was the 2008 study conducted by the institution together with Sri Lanka Railways and Ceylon Electricity Board, the three key institutions, or two key institutions, who will actually implement the project with the Institution of Engineers supporting. But as you heard, it didn't get very far. So of course we went in delegation and met all the possible ministers and secretaries, but didn't get far. And because, as you heard, there was a Chinese proposal which also did not get anywhere near implementation. As you heard, we are very close to implementation, but coming back to my argument as to there are so many sectors, how do you select the best sector for implementation, or the first sector to be implemented? There are various ways you can prioritize, you can do complicated economic calculations, modeling, etc. But our study took a very humble and simplistic approach, in which we said the sector that gives the largest benefit to the present traveling public, the people to whom we should say thank you, should be the first sector to be electrified, and the economics and the financial benefits are good, as we see. But of course, if we go further, Kalutara South Weyangoda, and perhaps include Polgahavila as well, maybe we would include 50% of those people going on the footboard and inside of the present railway network in this Panadura Weyangoda sector. So therefore, our recommendation, of course, which was vetted by our Indian counterparts as well, was to implement Panadura Weyangoda first. So therefore, that's a given conclusion. Now, how does Sri Lanka Railway save energy? There are various statistics available, and Sri Lanka Railways did a test run for us by the then General Manager Railways and his staff, and gave us the calculation with all the results that the electricity consumption per diesel electric unit was 4.27 per kilometer. We compared it with a variety of international figures. For example, a suburban train in Taiwan was reporting 7.6, an express train was in Sweden was reporting 8.2. Of course, if you know that wind resistance is proportional to the cube of the speed, so therefore express trains are less energy efficient than suburban trains. So therefore, for our study, we took a specific energy consumption of 5.5 kilowatt hours per electric multiple unit, or EMU is the electric equivalent for a diesel power set, without air conditioning and without regenerative braking. So we were a bit more conservative than the 4.27 that we got in the test. And of course, we should not forget about 30% more of energy can be recovered through regenerative braking. Regenerative braking is when you brake the train like your hybrid car. It hybrid car charges the battery, and the electric train sends electricity back to the grid. So, the fuel consumption of a diesel electric, diesel multiple unit, the diesel power set, and a comparative energy consumption of an electric power set. As you see, the energy cost 19.08 rupees for electricity, that includes the capacity cost as well, is less than half the cost of diesel as of now. Of course, prices vary up and down. Pricing can also be done in different ways. So, when the railway lines are electrified, it will look like this, a little bit complicated than what we have seen. This is a railway line which is being rehabilitated and being electrified. So this is perhaps the picture you can see. I see some paddy fields on either side, marshy lands, perhaps between Hulupitiya and Nerramulla area. This is the site that you may see in about 2 years, because this project is going to start by the end of next year. Of course, it needs time for detailed design. So track rehabilitation and electric infrastructure and the catenary, the wire that gives electricity to the train. The wire up there will be at 25 kV that will provide electricity to the train, and the return wire will be one of the rails. So therefore, current will return through one of the rails back to the supply point. Therefore, it is not dangerous to walk on the track from an electrical point of view, but from a mechanical point of view, you could be hit by a 100 kilometer train. So therefore, the track has to be fenced. Of course, fencing expressways is now considered to be acceptable. Everybody accepts that the expressway is fenced. You cannot have a small boutique by the side of the expressway. So therefore, we need to get the society to accept the fact that electrified tracks are designed for 100 kilometers per hour and they will be fenced. And of course, crossing points will have to be provided to the people on both sides of the track. Now, the financial benefits. If we simply assume the basic electrification, hang a wire, run an electric power set, basic in investment, then the project is very financially viable. It's not so expensive. It costs only under $50 million, and it has an annual saving of 285 million rupees. And in year 10, with the passenger growth, the benefits will be much higher, and the financial internal rate of return will be 2.8%. Now, that's not very attractive, but considering the fact that Sri Lanka Railways will have to buy either diesel power sets or electric power sets, we can only consider the incremental investments on the rolling stock. Then the financial benefit is relatively good at 15.2%. Hang a wire, run an electric train just like today, no further modifications except for small improvements. We move further. The railway electrification and modernization project, I emphasize modernization, goes way beyond hanging a wire and running an electric train. The project is structured presently as a pre-feasibility study prioritization, which is starting about now, and detailed designs coming in. It has training components, implementation in two segments, phase one, Panduravayangoda, and the second phase will be based on the outcome of the studies that are just about to start. So if you ask me what will be the other sectors to be electrified, whether the railway line near your house will be electrified, I do not know, because the first priority has been decided. Other priorities have to be organized after more detailed studies during the studies that are coming up shortly. So the total indicative investments, at this moment they are only indicative investments, phase one, $300 million, and as you heard, the government has been pledged a soft loan by the Asian Development Bank to implement this. Phase 2, another $300 million, soft loan already pledged, and phase 3 could be further investments from various other investors, multilateral agencies, the government itself, as we go on electrification with the segment by segment of the electrified network based on the priority that comes out. A technical brief of the full railway electrification projects. Long distance trains will continue to run on the electrified tracks. They will run express. So for that you need the capability of high speed, and train doors will be closed and air conditioning will be a standard feature. So we need to put those people in the footboard into the train and close the door and air conditioning. Tracks will be fenced, as I said, level crossings minimized and safety improved, overpasses and underpasses built, electronic ticketing, passenger information, stations upgraded, parking provided, disabled access provided. So we are talking about not merely electrification in the big project, it's electrification and modernization, so that this will be the most modern electrified railway system in South Asia in 2020. Benefits, we have discussed quite a lot, time saved and the costs of the project as I have listed here. No need to repeat them. Now, the modernization project in the current estimate for Pamadura Veyangoda is a $300 million project. $300 million project. These are the project numbers. Rates of return are negative. Rates of return are negative. Why? Because the cash benefit is not so representative of the true benefit of the project. And in the same way, if I exclude electric multiple units, the electric power sets, assuming that Sri Lanka Railways will have to buy diesel multiple units anyway, then it's slightly better but still negative. Now, financial benefits negative, and if you look at the economic benefit, this project will have high economic benefits, which will make the negative financial benefits to be positive economic benefits. I have not gone into quantifying the economic benefits because this will be the outcome of the upcoming study. Time saved, improved environment, ease of travel, saving of road infrastructure, saving of vehicles, using vehicles, lower maintenance costs on buses, and other economic benefits, as a railway will play a catalytic role in causing development in various locations in the country. So, of course, many have questions. The first question may be, why is IESL having this forum? IESL is, in my view, having this forum to tell its membership the project is on track, but the project needs your support. The project needs your support, not only the members, but the public at large, which will hear this through the media. The project needs your support to remain on track.
If I would like to intervene here, would you please narrate this via video proofs? This slide is in Sinhala, please.
Stuti, oba hitanama athi me sakatcha mandape pawathwanna hethu mokadda kiyala. මගේ අදහස හැටියට මේ සාකච්ඡා මණ්ඩපයේ පරමාර්ථය තමයි මේ දුම්රිය විදුලිකරණය ව්‍යාපෘතිය සහ නවීකරණ විදුලිකරණ සහ නවීකරණ ව්‍යාපෘතිය ආරම්භ වී ඇති බව ඉංජිනේරු ආයතනයේ සමාජිකයන්ටත් ඒ වගේම මහජනයාටත් දැනුම් දීම ඒ වගේම මේ ව්‍යාපෘතිය ඉදිරියට ගෙන යාමට ඔබ සියලු දෙනාගේම සහයෝගය අවශ්‍ය බව කීමට මොකද මේ ව්‍යාපෘතිය ගැන අප මේ සභාවෙන් ඇහැව්වොත් මම හිතන්නේ මේකට කැමතියි කියලා හැමෝම අත් දෙකම උස්සයි. නමුත් මේ ව්‍යාපෘතිය මේ විදිහට කළ යුතුද? මේක වෙන විදිහකට කරන්න පුළුවන්ද? එහෙම නැතිනම් මේක කළ යුතුමද? අපිට ඩීසල් වලින්ම මේක තව ටිකක් දුවා ගන්න බැරිද? ඒ වගේ විවිධ මත තියෙනවා. ඉතින් මම මගේ අවසාන ස්ලයිඩ් එක මෙතන තියෙන්නේ අපි මේ විදිහටම අපේ දුම්රිය සේවය පවත්වාගෙන යමු. ඒක සමහර දෙනෙකුට ප්‍රශ්නයක් වෙන්න පුළුවන්. නෑ නෑ ඩීසල් වලින් දුම්රිය දුවන එක ලාභයි. එහෙම අදහස් සමහර අයට තියෙනවා. ඒක එහෙම නෙවෙයි කියලා අපි පුන පුනා නැවත නැවතත් ගණනය කරලා පෙන්වා දී තිබෙනවා. මේ වගේ අලුත් දේවල් අපේ රටේ නම් කරන්න බෑ. එහෙම ඉලෙක්ට්‍රොනික ටිකටින් එහෙම මෙහෙ කරන්න බෑ. නමුත් අපි අනිත් රටවල් වඩා නවීන මොබයිල් ටෙලිෆෝන් එහෙම පාවිච්චි කරනවා. මේ අපි කොහොමද දුම්රිය පාරට වැට ගහන්නේ? ඒක කරන්න අමාරුයිනේ. එතකොට අපි මීටර් 100ක් විතර පළලා අධිවේගී මාර්ග සදා දෙපැත්තෙන් වැට ගහලා ගෙවල් 100 ගණනින් ඉවත් කරලා අපි වාහන 10,000ක් විතර යනවා දවසකට. නමුත් ඊට වඩා ඉතාම පටු දුම්රිය මාර්ග දෙක දෙපැත්තෙන් වැට ගහලා ඉතා අඩු ගෙවල් සංඛ්‍යාවක් ඉවත් කරන්න සිද්ධ වෙයි. අපි මේ මාර්ගයේ දැනට යන 400,000කට පහසුකම් සලසා ඒ ප්‍රමාණය දෙගුණ කරනවද නැත්නම් බැහැ කියලා නිකන් ඉන්නවද? ඉතින් මේවා තමයි අපිට තියෙන අදහස් සහ ප්‍රශ්න. අපිට රේල් පාරේ ඇවිදින්න බැරි වෙයිද? ඒකට උත්තරේ මම කිව්වා ඇවිදින්න පුළුවන්. නමුත් වේගය වැඩි නිසා අනතුර අදටත් වඩා වැඩි. මේ විදුලිය නැතුව ගියාම මොකද වෙන්නේ? විදුලිය නැතුව ගියොත් මොකද වෙන්නේ අපිට මේ කියන්නේ තවදුරටත් සාකච්ඡා කරන්න පුළුවන් විදුලිය නැතුව ගියොත් කෙටියෙන් මා කිව්වොත් ප්‍රධාන පද්ධතියේ විදුලිය නැතුව ගියොත් ඒක අවුරුදු කීපයකට සැරයක් තමයි වෙන්නේ එහෙම නැතුව ගියොත් බෑකප් ජෙනරේෂන් විදුලි ලංකා දුම්රිය සේවය සමග තියෙන්න ඕන අවම සේවයක් පවත්වාගෙන යෑමට සෑහෙන පරිදි ඒ බෑකප් ජෙනරේෂන් සමහර විට විදුලි බල මණ්ඩලයේම සමහර විට සපයන්නත් පුළුවන් ඒක සාකච්ඡා කරගන්න ඕන ලංකාවට පුළුවන් ද මේ වගේ නවීන දුම්රිය සේවය පවත්වාගෙන යන්න. එතකොට අනිත් දුම්රිය මාර්ගයේ කොටස් කවදාද විදුලිකරණය වෙන්නේ? අලුත් දුම්රිය මාර්ගයන් හදනවද? අපි ඒක මම හිතන්නේ මඩ පස්සෝ එන මහතුරුය ගැන කතා කරයි. මේ ව්‍යාපෘතියෙන් පස්සේ දුම්රිය දෙපාර්තමේන්තුව ලාභදායි වෙයිද? ඒකත් අපිට සාකච්ඡා කරන්න පුළුවන්. මගේ ගණනය කිරීම හැටියට නම් ලාභදායි වෙන්නේ නැහැ. අපි ඒකට වෙන ගොඩක් දේවල් කරන්න ඕන අපි මෙතන සාකච්ඡා කළේ අද පවතින සේවාව අදට වඩා ඉතා කාර්යක්ෂම ලෙස අඩු ඉන්ධන වියදමකින් පවත්වාගෙන යන ක්‍රමය අවසාන වශයෙන් පුද්ගලික අංශයට බැරිද මේ ආයෝජනය කරන්න මේ ආයෝජනය කරන්න පුද්ගලික අංශයට බැරිද මම හිතන්නේ මේ මෙතන ඉන්න බොහෝ දෙනෙක් දන්නව ඇති නැත්නම් කියවලා ඇති අපි අධිවේග මාර්ගවලට පුද්ගලික ආයෝජන ලබා ගැනීමට අවුරුදු ගාණක් තිස්සේ වෙහෙසුණා. නමුත් මේ වගේ ඒ සක්ෂක්‍යතා අධ්‍යයනය බලපුවහම ඕන කෙනෙකුට පේනවා අපරාධේ අපි මාන්සි වුණේ. මොකද ව්‍යාපෘතිය මුල්්‍යමේ වශයෙන් ලාභදායි නැහැ. මොකද මුල්්‍යමේ වශයෙන් ලාභදායි නම් පහුගිය අවුරුද්ද ඇතුළත අපිට මාධ්‍යයේ නැහුණු දේවල් අනුව කොළඹ නුවර අධිවේගී මාර්ග දෙකක් දැන් හදලා ඉවර වෙලා තියෙන්න ඕන විවිධ පෞද්ගලික අංශයයි ගෙනාපු යෝජනා අනුව. කොළඹ කටුනායක අධිවේගී දුම්රිය මාර්ගයක් හදලා ඉවර වෙන්න ඕන එකක් නෙමෙයි දෙකක් මම හිතන්නේ හදලා ඉවර වෙන්න ඕන මේ වෙලාව වෙද්දී මේක පෞද්ගලික අංශයට කරන්න පුළුවන් දෙයක් වුණා නම්. මොකද ප්‍රවෘත්ති පත්‍රය අරගෙන බැලුවොත් අපිට පේනවා ඕන් පැමිණෙනවා ඇමතිතුමාට දෙනවා යෝජනාවක් ඉතින් ඉතා හොඳයි කියනවා අපි ගිහින් එන්නම් කියනවා ඊට පස්සේ ඒගොල්ලන්ගේ බැංකු කරුවන් මෙහෙ එනවා අර ඩියු ඩිලිජන්ස් කියන එකට ඒකට ආවට පස්සේ ඒගොල්ලෝ කියනවා අනේ ඔකට නම් අත තියන්න එපා කියලා ඒක මේ මම හිතන්නේ ලංකාවේ වරදක්වත් ජනතාවගේ වරදක්වත් කියලා කරුණු අපි පස්සෝ කතා කරමු බොහොම ස්තුතියි
Before we begin the next small opening remarks, I would like to give a check on the time. We are probably about 15 minutes behind to my liking right now. We should have opened up the discussion. However, two important speakers are coming up. Gentlemen, I would like to invite both of you to mix it up in multiple languages because that's a group. I will next invite well-known personality for the last few years, particularly in the transport sector, without any further ado, Professor Amma.
Well, this hall is becoming to look like a railway carriage in peak period. Not quite. The door is crowded. We have a few people hanging on the windows. Probably it will look just right. I'm not an electrical engineer to say that electrification is better than diesel. I'm not even a railway engineer to say that railway is better than roads. I'm here speaking to you as a transportation engineer and planner who is always trying to look at the best modes of transport technology that are available to meet the ever increasing and complex mobility requirements of the people. People whose incomes are increasing, whose lifestyles are getting complex, and need more than one solution to get about. Now, why do we need to revive the railway at this time? Don't most of us think that the railway is a part of history? It belongs to the 19th century, maybe, not even the 20th century. It's loss making. Isn't that what we have been told all these years? Haven't we been told that getting a car and getting about is the more respectable thing to do? So why is IESL doing these crazy things? I mean, railway needs to be allowed to peacefully die and be replaced by more efficient modes of road transport we all like. In fact, I have been part of many conversations during the last 20 years of proposals to remove certain railway tracks. Thankfully, none of it got removed during the time I was around, but before that we know several tracks were removed. So why are we fighting this? What's changed today? Railway electrification has been there for the last 90 years, 92 years. We should take a bow if we finish it within the 100. So why? See, our roads give the answer. Can our roads cope with the mobility requirements? If our roads can cope with it, like many countries have shown, we don't really need a railway. Sri Lanka is not a very large country. It does not have very large urban areas. And certainly we should be able to manage most of our requirements with railway, with roads. But it's very clear that being an older city, our road network is limited. And therefore, even at present, if not for the railway, our transport situation would be much worse. Even now, to Columbus City, 12% of the people come by railway. And that increases to 20% during the peak period. And on some routes, it increases to 30%. So the railway is playing a very significant role. There's also another reason why the railway is needed. And that is, in a modern economy, choice is important. Different people prefer to travel in different modes. People traveling short distances prefer road-based transport. Buses, taxis are preferred. Those who travel longer distances, say more than 10-12 kilometers, would prefer a railway ride. So we need to offer both these to the public. We need to see the transport network as a complementary integrated system of transport, rather than seeing rails and buses and roads separately, which unfortunately many engineers are guilty of considering in piecemeal. Finally, the consumer doesn't care how he goes, as long as we provide that transport element for him. Increasingly, the world is talking about seamless transport, transferring from one mode to another, a ticket that can be used in any mode, information that is provided to the traveler of all the modes. And that is the direction in which future transport in Sri Lanka has to go. And in this case, I see that the railway now has a chance unlike never before to be part of that solution for the 21st century. It is true, the railways, not only in Sri Lanka, all across the world, lost its battle in the 20th century. It trounced water transport and became the champion in the 19th century, but it lost to the advent of motor vehicles in the 20th century. But the motor vehicles, the popularity of the motor vehicle, the affordability of the motor vehicle is now gradually killing us physically. And many cities are becoming uncompetitive, unlivable, because the motor vehicle has basically taken over. And now the railway has an opportunity to come with a solution for the 21st century. And I believe this opportunity of railway electrification and modernization is an opportunity that the railway has not been provided over the last 50 years or more to be competitive and to join the mainstream of transport supply, at least in the western province of Sri Lanka. And I think it needs all the support to be given this new lease of life to be competitive. Now, I believe that the title Railway Electrification and Modernization is inadequate for this project, because I feel that that doesn't go far enough. Because I feel that in order to deliver the potential of what is being planned, the electrification, the comfortable rides, the air conditioned rides, the seamless transfers, the electronic ticketing, the onboard, the at-grade level boarding, seamless access and real-time information, this is not enough. And I feel we need to electrify and modernize the railway department as well. Just running electrified and modern railways probably will not get us even out of the station. And therefore, I think the challenge is there to for the study team, ISL, the ministry that is represented here by the secretary and others, and the department that is represented here, to be ready to embrace this technology and to ensure that the institution is capable of delivering, not just handling the technology, capable of delivering the potential of the technology to the consumer. If not, $300 million, $600 million is cheap considering other modes of transport, but that money may not be well spent. So therefore, that is one other view that I may have, which others may agree or disagree. My final point is, why commuter railways? Why suburban railways? Today there are many other forms of rail technology that can be used in urban areas. A few weeks ago we were told publicly that Colombo is getting a light rapid transit. 2 weeks ago there were in the Facebook metro systems. Last week I read in the papers that cabinet approval is sought for a monorail system. So probably we are going to end up with all of these. If you have to believe any of these people. But one thing I know, nobody has done any feasibility for any of them. And probably the chance is that they will end up the way that most other projects have been announced by different people over the time. It's easy to come and say, this is what Colombo wants, without doing the numbers, without doing the feasibility, without having an idea of the comparative advantages and disadvantages of the different modes. We have to look at railway modernization and electrification from where we are. If we have unlimited money, we can go for whatever is most expensive. With this amount of money, maybe we can electrify the entire 200 kilometers of railway. But with that same money, probably you can only put a metro which is 10 kilometers. What do you think? Do you give the benefit to 100,000 people or 1 million people? Well, very simple things we have to look at. We all like to have high-end technology, but how many people will benefit? How much of capital, limited capital that this country has now can be allocated? How quickly can this be constructed and the benefit given to the people? How much will it cost to construct 1 kilometer? How much will it take to transport one passenger 1 kilometer? How will you get the people into the system? People prefer at grade, or would you rather take them 20 meters below or 15 meters higher? We have to look at all of these things. There are enough examples from all around the world where wrong transport solutions have failed. So finally, I want to conclude by saying that this is probably the best starting block for rail transport. There is opportunity for access modes to be developed to feed the railway stations, but we need to get the core, we need to get the current public transportation modes, the railway and the bus system, which is even at present catering to 52% of the trips in this province, to increase in number and to double, triple in the quality that they provide. And these are things we can do in a couple of years. The buses can be turned around even faster. This is not the forum to talk about that. But the railway, if we do now, we know that the basic rail technology can be made available to people within the next 5-6 years. And I think, as was mentioned, it is fully worthy of all our support. As the future rests with that. Thank you very much.
Now, our final panelist will be well-known firebrand speaker, public arena, and economist, Dr. Lakshmi Gunawan.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Ladies and gentlemen, in 2 years' time, you'll be traveling in a train, electrified train, Tilak. Thank you for you. 4 years, 2 years we will be starting, and 4 years we will be running. Okay. I'll be the happiest for two reasons, because I'm still a train traveler from Panadura, and not because of me, I think you selected Vayangoda Panadura. And secondly, because it appears like for after 90 years, we have come to a point now, there is no return. So ladies and gentlemen, let's take it when we leave this room today that there is no return to this, and this time we are going to have it, electrified railway system in this country. So let's have that resolution as professionals, as travelers, as officials, everyone. Tilak showed a book. It's a bit sentimental thing for me, because the study was done in 2008 when I was a general manager railway. We issued a letter, a draft cabinet memorandum to the Ceylon Lake City Board, prepared for joint cabinet memorandum to go in. And that was all what I knew until later in life. At a seminar, I was questioned as to what happened to the cabinet memorandum. So I said, well, as far as I know, it got lost in the Ministry of Power and Energy. To my surprise, it was not so. It got lost somewhere else, because Ministry of Power and Energy had given their consent and returned it back to somewhere, and it had got lost there. So in 2015, with the support of Tilak, Amal, Prayal and many others, and Institute of Engineers, and you, most of you are engineers here, we managed to get this cabinet paper up, and the cabinet approved it on the 8th of July 2015. So ladies and gentlemen, I'm very happy if this is going to go ahead this time, and I hope that all of us here will shout and say that we need electric railway. As Tilak said, at one time we were talking about coal power, and it happened. Likewise, this time, electrification, and it's going to happen, ladies and gentlemen. We will have it this time. As an economist, I need to add 2 points only at this discussion. Now, since we are going to have it, I think we have to be mindful of two things, or three things rather. You all hear these days a very famous slogan in everywhere you go, Patrawala Pitu Pirenna Viena, Me Rata Nayavela, Naya Ugulaki Hiravela, Dead Trap. ඒ කතාව ඇත්ත නම් ඇත්තද නැත්තද කියන එක අපි වෙනම සාකච්ඡා කරමු මේක නෙමෙයි ෆෝරම් එක ඒක ඇත්ත නම් අප මොකද කළ යුත්තේ අප කළ යුතු දේ තමයි කරන ඩෙවලොප්මන්ට් ප්‍රොජෙක්ට් එක ඉතාම අඩු කැපිටල් ඉන්ටෙන්සිටි එකකින් කරන්න ඕන මේ කියන්නේ ගුණාත්මක භාවය කැප කරලා නෙමෙයි අදාළ පිරිවිතරයට අදාළ ප්‍රමිතියට හැබැයි අවම ප්‍රාග්ධන පිරිවැයක් ඇතුව කරන්න ඕන. එතකොට තමයි හිඟන්නගේ අතේ තියෙන සල්ලි ටික පොඩ්ඩක් හරි ඉතුරු වෙන්නේ. So I urge the policy makers and the public that the railway electrification be done at the lowest possible investment to the country because we are indebted, heavily indebted. First point. මෙහෙම බලනකොට ප්‍රියල් කියනවා 1970 ගණන් වල electrification was 18 million Sri Lankan rupees and Tilaksimbala PTS and railways and CEB study in 2008 had 50 million Sri Lankan US dollars, which amounts to only 0.7 million dollars a kilometer if you divide by the number of kilometers roughly. And today we talk of about 100 million comparable, plus if station development then everything comes together, it's about 300 million, and that still comes to less than 5 million dollars. As Amar said very, very clearly, if you can get it for 5 million dollars per kilometer, there is no logic justification under the sun that you spend anything more than this for railway electrification. So let's also press the policy to the policy makers, as engineers and as professionals, as academics, as public transport users, that for heaven's sake don't spend more than what is required for these kind of projects. The second thing is, whichever way we go, when we don't have capital we have to go for borrowings. So when we have, the country is facing heavy debts, it's always important that we go for the lowest possible interest rate. ඒ නිසා තමයි ගරු රංජිත් මත්බණ්ඩාර මහතුමාගේ නායකත්වයෙන් පසුගිය 2015 වසරේදී ආසියානු සංවර්ධන බැංකුව සමග සාකච්ඡා කරලා අපට පුළුවන් වුණේ ADB එකේ පෝට්ෆෝලියෝ එකට මේ ඉලෙක්ට්‍රිෆිකේෂන් දාගන්න. ADB එක මල්ටිලැටරල් ඩෝනර් කෙනෙක්. You all know that. When it is multilateral donor funding, it comes at very concessionary terms, even though we don't get the lowest possible interest rates because of our level of economic development now. I think we are going to get somewhere around 1.5 to 2% interest rate. And I saw yesterday in the TV, Honorable Finance Minister was talking about $1,000 million credit given to government of Sri Lanka by ADB. He said 1.2%. Let's say even 2%. Forget about 1.2. 1.2 is much better. Like even if it is 2%. I don't think any other credit source can match that kind of interest rate. The third thing, third imperative I'm referring to is, we are a developing economy and most of us here, excluding me, are engineers. It is always important for the country's economy that we do things in such a manner that the maximum multiplier effect is accrued to the national economy. අපි මේ project එකක් කරනකොට කවුරු හරි donor කෙනෙක්ව ගෙනල්ලා දාගෙන ඒ donor එයාගේ contractor කෙනෙකුට business එක දීලා ඒ contractor ඇවිල්ලා මෙහෙ implement කරලා ගියාම what do we have? Finally we will end up having the asset. That's all. We won't get any other benefits that otherwise would have been possible if you implement it locally. As much as possible. I know railway electrification cannot be implemented 100% locally, though maybe when we were talking about long time ago it may have been possible, but today there may be cases where we want to get the state of the art technology which is not available in Sri Lanka, but there are many things we can do locally. So maximum possible value added, maximum possible domestic economic value added should be sought by implementing these kind of projects. And that is why in the cabinet memorandum in 2015, it was very specifically mentioned. Let me read from the draft, because I don't have the exact words, but I had the kind of draft that I had done at that time. Cabinet paper number 2015-16 MT. the approval has been obtained on July 8, 2015. Nirdeshati enna mehemai. Dumriya viduliya karaneta rajya ayojane pramukhatave labadi yutuya. Deka dumriya viduliya karaneyatulu mahaparimana vyapruti deshiya aarthike gunakara vardhanayak labagata haki paridi hakita deshiya vyavasayakatveha deshiya takshanika gnane upakari karaganiminda අමුද්‍රව්‍ය ශ්‍රමය ඇතුළු අනෙකුත් සම්පත් හැකියතා දේශීයව සම්පාදනය කර ගනිමින්ද ක්‍රියාත්මක කිරීමට ක්‍රමවේදයක් සකස් කිරීමට නිර්දේශ කරමි. මේ නිර්දේශ දෙකත් එක තමයි අර තිලක් ඉදිරිපත් කරපු 5-4 අනුමැතිය ඉල්ලලා තියෙන්නේ. මේකෙන් කියවෙනවා අපේ මේ ඉම්ප්ලිමෙන්ටේෂන් මෙකැනිසම් එක පුළුන්තරන් නැෂනල් ඉකොනොමික් ඩ්‍රයිවිං මෙකැනිසම් එකක් විය යුතුයි. මේ තුනම මම ඔයගේ කරුණු තුන එක අපි නායකාරයා අපි නම ණය වෙච්ච මිනිස්සයා ණය වෙච්ච මිනිස්සයා අපි ඕනකට වඩා වීදම් කරන්න නරකයි ඉතාලම අඩුම වීදමින් මේක කරගන්න ඕන දෙක we should be not getting very high interest rate loans තුන we have to drive the local economy to the maximum possible extent by implementing these kind of projects and after all you are all engineers then only you get the jobs then only you get the opportunity to develop your skills and then only you really become mavisuru neda mavisuru neda me engineeru mahaturunta singalen kiyanne ehema naththam ini mavisuru nemeni mavisuru wenna nan you have to get involved in mavima nirmanashilitta so we need to have these three ladies and gentlemen may I propose it is only through competitive bidding that you can achieve all these international competitive bidding whenever you don't have local local capacity if you have local capacity give it local bidding if you don't have then go for international competitive bidding adb or world bank or any other multilateral donor is very clear on that we have to go on competitive bidding if ever you go for other kind of sources particularly bilateral credit සමහරලාට ජපන්ු ගියයි සමහරලාට ඉන්දියාව ගියයි සමහරලාට චීන ගියයි සමහරලාට තව යුරෝපේ ගියයි ජර්මනිය ගියයි තව කොහේ හරි ගියයි ඒගොල්ලන්ගේ ලෝන් එකක් අරන් ආවොත් ඒගොල්ලන්ගේ කොන්ට්‍රැක්ටර් තමයි එන්නේ එතකොට යන්නේ නෙගෝෂියේටර් ප්‍රොජෙක්ට් එකක් මිසක් කම්පිටිටිව්ලි බිඩඩ් ප්‍රොජෙක්ට් එකක් නෙමෙයි and on the one hand this government has no ethical grounds to get involved with those things because they came into power particularly rejecting the unsolicited proposals and uncompetitively bidded projects that was their ground when they competed in the elections in 2015 January there is no logic for them there is no excuse for them to revert back to those kind of policies and to go and get money through unsolicited sources or bilateral credit without competitive process in it even if you go for bilateral sources there is a way that you can make it very competitive by putting it to competitive bidding with the credit source that they are coming in so I suggest that we all lobby as a group for these three principles api nayakaru vidiyata anavashya indira nay ganna narakai me wede karanna ona deweni eka ihala interest rate ekata api yanna narakai apita ganna puluwam lowest interest rate ekata api yanna ona තුන්වෙනි එක හැකි උපරිම මට්ටමින් දේශීය තාක්ෂණය දේශීය ඥානය දේශීය සම්පත් වලට එකතු අගයක් එන විදිහට අපි මේ වැඩේ කරන්න ඕන. ඒ සඳහා මයිලා හිටිනවා අපිට මහඟු අවස්ථාවක් ADB එකේ අපිට උදා කරලා තියලා තියෙන්නේ. ADB එක ඉදිරිපත් කළා කියලා අපිට සල්ලි දෙන්න. It is up to the policy makers to steer it and make our dream a reality that Gunarwan will be travelling in an electric train 4 years from now, from Panaduru to Colombo. Thank you very much.
What matters is the public understands this. However, when I look at the clock there, we have 45 minutes. Depending on the enthusiasm, we can extend it to another maybe 60 minutes. So let's begin the conversation without any further ado. This is the plan. We have mics here. There will be two mics with us and take two mics. Somebody help me here. Damit or somebody, we have to find you. Mice, two mice to the side. Now please pass this very fast because the house is packed. So take two mice and pass it to the one to the left and one to the right. We will keep two mice for our panel members. Tilak, if you don't mind, please grab one and one to you and one to PR or somebody on the other side. We have two mics here. I got my Apple mic. Now, this is the day. This is where I come in. Excuse me. Now, what I like to do is this. One person at a time, raise your hand. I will give you the opportunity. You have to state your name and the organization or whatever the interest that you have regarding this particular subject matter. Just a quick one. I would like to emphasize that do not initially give any comments. Let's get the questions out first, short and sweet questions, one at a time. You'll get your second or third chance if you have three questions later. Everybody gets a chance. Questions first. Raise your answer. That's all. You drive anything. Yes, please. Questions.
My name is Gunaratnan, DEA. Question is, not one of the speakers at all. The funds are available, planned, everything.
Excuse me, ladies and gentlemen, these mics are more on the direction of security right next to your mouth.
Planning done, all these things are very good, but it is not moving. Question is, before the moving, where is the land available according to the plan to set up? Particularly from Colombo Port to Pandurai, whether it is a corridor, required corridor for the electrification of the railway available. Long before, some of the up to some certain extent land available, but many of the areas enclosed by the people and government given, particularly in front of Balavasta, Bambarapidi and the other station, front of bus service, there have been joint services there to gather the passengers. Most of the trains are running empty. After the once the office hours complete, most of the trains are coaches are running empty. Because bus services not giving the proper passenger collection. No space to stop the buses at Bambalapidi, even up to Halton South, at Angulan, Morato. We had a large space, but everything is
right.
The question is, first thing is, before do all these things by the foreign party or whoever it is, whether we have acquired the sufficient land.
Thank you. We'll take that question.
Good luck. Thank you very much for that question. I think you raised a very valid point. My answer to that is, there's a will, there's a way. If the government can acquire land in Dibrugarh, say at Colombo 7 and widen the road that you, Marine Drive, and then you can have Dibrugarh Sai road from Dibrugarh Sai right up to police park, police barracks. If you can have that kind of expensive acquisitions and pave the way for highways, why not the railway? You only pay the people the due compensation. Government makes a decision and it is not going to be that expensive. And that will be part and parcel of the project. And the project can take care of that. And the people will be provided already housing. You are right, 100%. That has to be one of the most important priority steps. Yes.
Do you permit to have a few words? Sorry.
No, not that yet, sir. Let me go with the first with the question. I'll give you a chance. Your question.
Yeah. It's not a question, actually.
I think I got that question.
I am the Bureau of the Institute of Engineers. And here, actually, I took over office after November 1, September last year. So I saw this cabinet paper. And there is recent development. Last week, the mission, ADB mission came and we had the kickoff meeting. There we discussed with the ADB. They are in the process of selection of consultant. And the consultant will be here by, hopefully by towards end of July. So we can activate the PMU, and already we have got the approval from the management service to the project management unit, and we'll be advertising very soon for the project manager. So once the selection of the project manager, so he can go ahead with the selection of other Kaburian staff. But there is a requirement, actually, there is a circular, because now our hands and legs are very tight. Actually, there are so many controls now. So we have to strictly follow the procedure. So there is a management that we circulate. So according to the convention that you have. Actually, we have to get the approval from the government. Accordingly, we have to start a campaign. And the same steering committee can continue under the EIC. The same steering committee can continue. And there we can get the participation of the board. So that is what actually I was doing with you. And regarding the basic project implementation.
So I would still like to remove the mic. Just bring it in for me.
Basic project implementation. Now we discussed with the ADB the priorities within the project. Priorities within the project. Because today we know the stretch between Kalambe and Kandy, there is a big demand for railway. Even yesterday we had a railway ride from Kandy to Kalambe. So we came in 2.5 hours. Whereas by road it takes more than 4 hours. So there is a big demand. But unfortunately we can cope up with, we cannot cope up with the demand because we don't have a sufficient road stock. And this year we are going to call open tenders to procure 10 engines to run in Afghan. So they are also the treasury has not currently been funded. So treasury wanted us to go ahead with the procurement with or without funding and then come to the treasury and we have to request the extension. So accordingly we are going to give the extension. And even the rolling stock, we have our rolling stock, the one part of the carriages. There are 600 carriages brought from Romania. Actually, those are really need the repair, major, I think, overhaul. And we must see whether it is economically feasible also. If the cost is more, there is no point of doing more. So, that is the priority of the railway. And the number two is the track upgrade. So that is actually number one priority in this electrified railway because it is the speed which brings the passengers to the train. So without passengers actually we cannot make the necessary income. Because we have to support the treasury to repay the loan. So then I discussed with the ADB to implement the project in stages. Number one priority should be to track upgrade. Then we have to run at 100 and then we have to protect the railway right of the way because you cannot have too many level crossings and passenger and crossing animals coming into the track. Should be like highway because otherwise there will be danger because the trains are moving at a very high speed. And other one is the signal. Our signaling system and the control panel at Maradana is more than 30 years old and there are frequent breakdowns. So we want ADB to actually give priority for the road track rehabilitation and the signaling in the whole process. Then it will be done in stages and our ultimate target is the electrified railway.
There's another hand going up, I saw.
Yes, you want to
take a question? Yeah.
Go ahead.
I think that's very happy to know that ADB and the ministry is making progress. And I want to also say that railway electrification has to be seen as one final product. The railways is actually guilty of not providing total solutions to the passengers for many years. It's always a case of improving the tracks, but you don't improve the rolling stock. In another 5 years, you forget the track and buy rolling stock. In another 5 years, you go and buy signaling. So at no point are you giving a total service to the passengers. So I want to very much emphasize that railway electrification and modernization should be all of what you said in one project and not bits and pieces. You cannot really have railway electrification with access to, as Gunaratna said, to the stations. We need to have the top class signaling systems. We need to improve the track. We need to do all of these within these 200 kilometers of track. Otherwise, it's going to be another case of piecemeal development of the railways, which will not deliver what a competitive transport scenario wants. So I hope the ministry will succeed in keeping the coherence of the project intact, so that actually what is expected with railway electrification, not just bits and pieces of components, will be delivered. Not a signaling system in Maradana and EMUs somewhere else, and track railways in somewhere else. No, take one track, maybe make it part of the way or whatever, and make sure everything that a modern electrified railway needs is there.
I think the best solution for that is that we set up the project management unit or whatever, the steering right. committee, and meet frequently. And that's where you should come out with the details of the project. And then the whole, how, at what level, which intervention would come through, will be determined there. As Amal said, we should not make the same mistakes that we have done in the past. So we should learn from the previous mistakes and go forward. But let me ask you a question, Mr. Secretary, because we make a policy decision that we will be going for diesel multiple units rather than locomotives even for the long haul. So why importing locomotives? I don't know, maybe not a relevant question here, but when you said that you are going to have locomotives imported, why not diesel multiple units? Then you are solving two things. One, you are solving the replenishment of your rolling stock. Two, your old carriage stock also is being automatically replaced there.
Do you
have
a short answer to that,
Mr. Secretary?
The mic is there.
I think we will electrify only the urban area.
That's right.
Maybe less than 200 kilometers. But the railway has to manage 1,600 kilometers. So, rest of the area, we have to have BMUs and the locomotives for freight transport. Because in the past, we had 100 freight trains. Today we are operating with the
freight
operation and long distance.
Long distance we design. Can we now? The thing is, as far as I can see, to electrify the suburban area, diesel manufacturers which are now running in suburban areas can be pushed to the other sectors like candy, maybe go or net area. So that also can be taken into account. You can't have all the functions that you are running, diesel manufacturers you are running, along with the electrical manufacturing in the future.
Right. Now, what I'd like you to digress a little bit from there. Just a quick point I would like to make based on my studies, getting ready for this. I think I would like confirmation from the secretary as well as my panel members. To go for electrification, there has to be volume, right? Passenger volume. It's interesting though, there's a term used called spark effect. There's a term used in analysis called spark effect. What spark effect is that people, there's a study being done that once you have electrified railways, the comfort, the smoothness, the speed, they have all those things, it tends to attract more passengers than diesel locomotives. So that's called a partial. There are debates whether that is really because of electrification or just because you do the right things. But anyway, nevertheless, you need to have volume. So the electrification is mostly right now, the panel members are focusing on the urban area, the Colombian area, right? Yes, quick question.
Yes, I'm Ranjan Sanak, ex-railway employee, retired. My question is, allowed or not,
it has to be a question.
Now, when the highway is going to be developed, they have the national road master plan. So, that it originated in 2006 and it continues till 2017. 2006 to 2017. Why don't we have a master plan as Professor Aman Kumar mentioned, we have signaling to come in, we have locomotives to come in, we have carriages to come in, we have tracks to be modernized. We have a lot of items in the pipeline. And at the moment, the railway management present here will testify that we have a lot of railway projects in the pipeline that are to be taken up very soon. But I propose a master plan immediately to be started by the steering committee itself. And furthermore, with its requirement, Dr. Uruvan's requirement of traveling by train in 2020 by an electrified train, I would like to point out one thing. That is, you cannot run at 95 per hour between Veyangode and Pandur. You can never run because there is curves at Bemul, curves at Yagur, curves at Kanemul, curves at Kampa, curves at Ragaman, Nermul, Kalania, Boat, Pompadavinja, Pompadavinja. So, the presence of the general manager in charge of infrastructure of the railway is present in the forum. So, I would like to propose that through the steering committee we give a immediately. Get this area surveyed. See what our land requirements are, as we pointed out. And go for land acquisition, start now itself, so that this project will be could be completed by 2020 and not otherwise, sir.
Thank you. I would like to get to the very back end of it. Now pass the mic. Let's see, you can play rugby or something and throw it. Pass it. Wait. We want to get it recorded, that's why. Pass it fast. Let's see whether we can
my question goes to Dr. Kripal sir. How energy demand? Can you explain about energy demand and how you can make the energy demand more electrification?
Are you asking that from Dr. Kripal sir or anyone?
The demand of an accelerating electric multiple unit is 1.2 megawatt at most. And obviously, we don't expect all the electric multiple units to accelerate at the same time. Even in a rare case, if you have 10 units accelerating at the same time, we are looking at 12 megawatts against a national demand of 2,400 megawatts. So therefore, from a system point of view, there is no issue in providing the capacity as well as the energy. True, there are problems in the system, but in the longer run, just consider India, that is having load shedding all year round in most states, have electric trains. So they have the required backups and a certain level of reliability is maintained. So therefore, that's how the electricity supply will be maintained. Before I return the mic, just a quick thing. To all the government officials, the railway officials and everybody, do not dilute the project Panadura Veyangode by talking about other options, other woes, other difficulties of the railway network. These were there in the past. These will be there in the future. And look at the future. Do not live in the past.
I just want to give a comment on what Rajit San had to mention. I think we are people who work with the earlier are here. And if one is Mr. Ujjay Kumar, he is here. I think he knows that between Tabukka and Bor, trains ran at 100 km per hour during my time. We could not sustain that because of the tsunami. So we had sent some of the leaders back to post life to return at that time. That's why we could not sustain. Otherwise, trains ran 100 km per hour, excepting certain curves. That is true. In any country, there are restrictions. When you say 100 km per hour, it is a permissible. Not that any everywhere that you can drive 100 km per hour. So, anyway, you know, your suggestion is very good. I mean, that is to acquire land and see as much as possible drive 100 km per hour, but that should be the second stage of the project, not the initial. Why the project help? It's good ongoing. So, when the trains are running, you can see where it is possible to see that the curves are reduced and normal speed will be maintained.
Thank you. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to definitely point the finger to some of the younger generation engineers or public here. I see an interesting gentleman right in the middle.
My name is Lakshmana Mesekadar. I would like to ask my professor, now this mega police project and this particular project, are there two projects or is it an integrated project where all are working together or different teams in different ways. How to integrate this?
Now, the one of the best ways to do is to pass the mic to another guy so that we do not ask it second time. Right, now the answer is.
Why me?
No, it's, I think it's a very, very common sense question from the planning member, because there's a megapolis going on, and this is there, and Dr. Lakshman Jack said, right? He said that 70% of the megapolis in the first 5 years is all about transport, right? It's a very valid common sense question.
The megapolis has a number of proposals, railway proposals, elevated railway proposals, elevated highway proposals, and so on. You really don't see the analysis as to what comes first. There are certain routes that are marked out. We still haven't seen the numbers justifying one over the other. So I cannot actually speak on behalf of the status of the megapolis plan in terms of where does electrification fit vis-a-vis everything else. I hope I'm clear on that. On the other hand, the studies that have been done by the Institution of Engineers and the University of Moratuwa and right along very clearly show that there are two modes of transport that need to be privatized. One is the modernization of the railway, and this project is very much in that. The other is the modernization of the bus network. Now both of those are in the megapolis plan. They are in the megapolis plan. So we are hopeful, especially in light of the recent cabinet paper that has gone, that these will remain the first priorities as they should be, and that no other projects which is siphon off funds or dilute attention would take place until the current modes of transport are fully developed to their potential. Planning for them can take on, and I think in the next 5 year windows, I think these two modes need to be prioritized. So we don't know yet the status of analysis of the megapolis to tell us whether it remains a priority. We are hoping that the numbers done earlier by different parties would remain as the driving force of modernizing transport in the western province.
I would like to add something to the question as well as the statement by Professor. I have been to 4 planning meetings about megapolis, including 2 days ago. My suggestion is that, for very good reasons, let's not get involved in megapolis questions, because I think megapolis team itself is still trying to put a team together to do the plan. And there will be a session at IDSA, maybe 1 or 2 sessions. In fact, the first one is coming up on the 9th day, part of the transport side of the megapolis lecture. So please come to that. But it's very clear to us that when we were there 2 days ago, or 3 days ago last week, I can't remember exactly what the date was, that still the team is put together to do the detailed development plan. Funding has to come, so let's not go there. Let's focus. I have a question, and then I will give a couple of questions to the left hand side. I have a question. Simple question. It seems to me the premise of this today's session is something like this. We have the potential to, rather not potential, actually we really can get the ADB low at a very concessional rate to electrify Paranaduvar Veyagoda stretch, period. We can do it. It's like someone giving the money and saying, here's the money, you can build a house, something like that. Okay. Meantime, the transport secretary, like he should do, gave a litany of things that the railway system should handle. Understood, because electrification will take place not only in Colombo, but there are so many other railway tracks, Kandra, Kandy, and all those things are there. My question as a citizen is that if we do take the loan and we do spend it on this electrification project, get it done the way you mentioned, Pilar, all the fancy things, railway tracks, fences, you name it, everything. What we will have is a showpiece, right? How things can be. What then? Because we are not a country that generates money. you know, next stage also we will have to get some funding extra. So what then? We get it done after 5 years. More people will travel, hopefully. Naturally, ideally, personally, ideally people will travel. But what then? Well, I mean, what's the rationale for saying let's do the electrification project Mandura Bayambaras, right? Get it done. Do not mix it up with other railway issues that are out there and dilute the project. That's the basic premise, right? The money is available, let's get it done. Once you do it, strategically, where is your head? The team's head? Where are we going with it? Beyond that, what next? What next? Yeah.
Of course, what next means? What other sectors to modernize and electrify?
And how?
Under the bear. Now, for that, there is a study commencing, as we heard very shortly, to reassess all the sectors and look at the studies that have been done recently. There have been many studies of various modes of transport, review them, and then prioritize the modernization and electrification of the remaining sectors. So it's going to be an ongoing process, and we have so much of experience in the power sector. We don't have to wait till 2020 to start the second segment. By about 2018, when the first segment construction begins, you start work on the second segment studies and retail design. So by 2019, another segment construction will begin. Now you might ask where the money is going to come from. If we behave well as good implementation agencies, good project management units, well staffed, and do our things on time, there will be adequate amounts of money coming in from multilateral lending agencies. There will be other lenders, AIIB, the China-led international, the new one, and the World Bank. And all these agencies will be knocking on the door, seeing Sri Lanka's success with electrification of one sector, particularly seeing the economic benefits to the country. So I believe there will be no stopping until the last segment of the network is electrified and modernized within economic viability, not just doing anything and everything within economic viability, and upgrading the rest of the network to provide a good service through diesels to the long distance passenger.
Yeah, just to add something. If you look at the potential of the railway, there are three thrust areas the railway can develop. One is urban commuter. The other is port-based container transport. The third is long distance passenger transport. If you take urban passenger transport, the biggest economic returns will be there because of the congestion. You will not make money, you will not make it profitable. It will be very unlikely. There are no railways in the world that is making money on urban passenger transport. If you go into the freight, you will make economic savings as well as financial savings. And that is a project that will be led by the private sector. I can see where government needs to get involved in all aspects, maybe in some. Long distance passenger services will neither be financially remunerative or economically remunerative. And I think that's where government has to take a call, and railway has to realize it may be that you need to let highways take a lead. Money is available, sir. If the government has taken a decision to build the central expressway up to Kandy, why should we be building the railway as well? Let's evaluate a decision, one or the other. So I think we need to be thinking not only of road master plan and railway master plan, we need to have Mr. Dishanayake of transport master plan. Otherwise, the railway gets money to do what they want and the roads get money to do what we want. Finally, there's nothing that the people want that gets done.
Thank you. Now let's take a question from this side. The mic place with the gentleman. Who got the mic? I want the mic place with the left hand. Yeah, there's a mic coming there. Yeah, there's a mic.
In the meantime, just one comment to Amal's response. I think Amal, even in the long distance express train, the railway has a role to play. Based on the time savings that you can have and based on the energy efficiency. I don't think if you talk about rural train services in the distance areas, there may not be economics. But I'm sure if you really study the comparative economics of highway, expressway, and express railway, you'll be probably realizing that.
I think it will be safer to leave it at the national transport plan, right? I think otherwise you use the Antarvaya model stretch. So, go ahead, sir. Tell your name, organization.
Good afternoon, everybody. I am Jayan Sirikumar from Sri Lanka Standard Institution. Actually, I want to you ask this now. Are we gathering everything or are we going to work out? Are we taking the Malachi? ये हॉस्पिटल भी इतने का बड़ा लगा, बड़ा तंगोल पुरवा 100 किलोमीटर पर आवर का हजार आना भी पुरवा, मेरे का अपने सारे दिन में अपने कराना पुरवा, अंतिम का तो मैं ला, लोग के हम डाटा का मैं स्टैंडर्ड्स को ला, इलेक्ट्रिफिकेशन वाले कराने स्टैंडर्ड्स बोटा ला, ये ना वा, अब इधर एक्सेस कराना पुरवा, आप ये बताते हैं अभी पूरा सपोर्ट के देना और ला आप ही ना बोल आइए इसको एक ना पता चला यही ना लगे ना अपने एक्सेस देना मिल बोल ये फिलहाल का भी ये तो आप इधर ये बताते हैं अभी सारा के दिन ये बात ये मानते के तमाम आप लोग तब नोट दें और जाने का अगर बिन्दु को अगर आप ही सिलेक्ट बिन्दु को और मिलने के लिए शिक्षा के लिए के उधर में जो सिंगल के वगैरह रखा लगा तो जैसा मेरे वगैरह डिस्कशंस दिखे तो तमाम ये इतना बुरा ये वगैरह हम लोग मार्केट के रास्ता भी गाना होगा ඉතින් මේ පස්සේ අපි මුළු දෙනෙක් යනකොට පස්සේ අපි සතුරු වෙන අපිත් ඒ කෝච් එකේ යනවා එහෙනම් තමයි ඉන්නේ අපි දැන් මේ ජන ජෙනරේෂන් එකේ මේ පැත්තට යනවා මේ ඉන්නේස් අපේ පරණ අයද සපෝට් එකේ මේ සිංහලයෝ කියන්නේ ලේසි පාස් මිනිස්සු මේ ඊළඟ වැඩට ගෙන්න ඕන ඒ වැඩ දෙන්නන්න ඕන ඒකයි ඉතින් අපේ මේ ડોક્ટર අවුරුදු ගානක් තිස්සේ මේ ප්‍රොජෙක්ට් එක මම BMS එකක් මේ ප්‍රොජෙක්ට් එක ඉහිස්සේ එතනමල් හස්ටේල් වල ට්‍රාන්ස්පෝට් ඒකත් මම දැක්කා ડોක් දෙන්නම් හිටියේ මේ නිසා අපි දෙන්න පුළුවන් මේ දේ අපි දීලා මේක ලස්සනට කරගෙන ගිහිල්ලා අපි නැති වුණත් අපි අනාගතයේ වෙන ෆියුචර් ජෙනරේෂන් එක මේක මොකද මාස් ට්‍රාන්ස්පෝට් කියන එක තමයි දැන් ලෝකෙ පිළිගන්න තියෙන මෝඩ ට්‍රාන්ස්පෝට් වලින් බස් ට්‍රැෆික් පාස් ගොඩක් දේවල් දිනවා මේ මේවට ගෙන ගත්තා අපිට තේරෙන්න ඕන රටවල් කොහොමද දිනවලා තියෙන්නේ අපිට අපිට අන්ඩර්ස්ටෑන්ඩින්ග් එක මැදි නිසා තමයි අපි අර ඒ කියන්නේ ලෝකේ අනිත් රටවල් කොහොමද දිනු වෙලා තියෙන්නේ කොයි විදිහට විතර තියෙන්නේ මේ සයන්ටිෆික් නොලෙජ් එක කොයි විදිහට අපි හැම කෙනාටම ලබා දෙනවා නම් ෂෙයාරින් නොලෙජ් අපි එක්ක ගන්න. මේකේ පොයින්ට් එක තාම අපි හර අනු පහතර දුන්නා මේක හරියටම එයා ඉෆෙක්ට් එක වෙන්නවා. ඒක තමයි කියන්නේ. Thank you very much.
Thank you. කාගේද? Any other questions? Yeah, coming to you. Any other questions? Fresh hands going up?
हमारे
ඉතින් දෙකම් දෙක පොටෙන්ෂල් එකක් තියෙනවා
ये पोटेंशियल को अभी इंडियन कार्ड में ठीक है प्रश्न किया है हमें मीटर में ये पोटेंशियल के इंडियन कार्ड में कोई अगर सुनामी आता हो ऐसा रिएक्शन आता हो ऐसा उधर से भी आता हो इन इफ यू बैक पेन ऑन है तो आप क्या होती है ना जाने की ना ये वेटिंग करना
आई वुड लाइक टू आप कहते नहीं कटा उधर जाके
जीएमआर का टेक्निक पक्का पूरा हो गया
राइट Ma'am, I think what Priyan is trying to say is that everybody is trying to say, and I say that everybody is trying to say is that there are, yes, I'll give you an answer. What Priyan says is that that is normal, Priyan. Now, any nation will under crisis will step up to the plate, any nation for that matter, even the weaker nation will step up to the plate. What some of our younger generation is suggesting is to have a vision and make it the crisis to get there. That is why we titled this particular topic, we said, Railway electrification necessity yesterday. Again, India, Vidurikar ne karanda, ek karan tu ne liye. Toh na, ek crisis se jana mat kiya ho. Ek toh maapi kya na tha?
I'm Hasala, an electrical engineer. So, if we go to the old railway station, we can see the state of the station is not really good. So, what that reflects is that it is not a priority to maintain the station, and there is money lacking in the system. And if you look at sort of the numbers, it was 15.9 billion the cost for the railway recurrent cost. According to the Central Bank annual report, and then the revenue was 5.9 billion. So it's like 11 billion losses just for the record, just for running. The point that I'm trying to make is that if you just look at the economics or the economic feasibility, and looking at the past of what has happened, on where we just look at the economic feasibility and the result in Sri Lanka. So, should we not also think about the financial feasibility? Because economic feasibility itself has not been a successful model, because buses, trains, up to now, it's an economically feasible thing. But the government, the nature of this thing, the nature of the problem is political, it's organizational, I think. And then, do you think that without giving the necessary empowerment to the organization to make the capacity required to serve the train service, would it be sufficient to change the engineering perspective without prioritizing also on the real problem? Yeah, so that's my question.
Shall I ask a quick one? Very interesting question. Let me answer this way. Your question had three parts. One is whether we should go on financial viability and not economic viability. The second question is why railway has inefficiencies to evolve and cannot maintain even the old railway station. Three, why the recurrent cost was 15 billion and revenue was 5 billion or something. Let me first start with your last question. You are referring to the 2015 figures. Of 2014 figures in the 2015 report. The current expenditure is 16 billion. Have I disallowed the level? It's only 10 billion. It's going to be how good the scene has happened. You know, who do I mean? Mark made that come out of the hill. The last, එතකොට ඒ ආනන්ද සංස්ථාවල 6 මිලියන් ගෙවුවාම එක පාට report කරනවා මහා ලොකු expenditure එක.
ඒ අවුරුද්ද යන කරුවන් බුදුවම්මෝ රේල්වේ යකේ ඒක හරියන්නේ නැහැ. We need to take kind of a counting practice. ඒ නිසා ඔබතුමාගේ ඒ ඒ ෆිගර් එක ගැන නැවත හිතන්න.
Good
right. දෙක අපි හිතමුකෝ මේක ෆ්ලැට් දැම්මා කියලා. දැන් අපි මේ ප්‍රශ්න අහන්නේ ෆයිනෑන්ෂල් ෆීසිබිලිටි කියන්නේ ඉකොනොමික් ෆීසිබිලිටි. රේල්වේ ඔය ඔය කොස්ට් එක ඇතුලේ දිනන මේ බුදු අම්මේ ස්ටේෂන් එක පාර පාලම සිග්නල් ට්‍රේන් කන්ට්‍රෝල් දැන් මේ ටික ඔක්කොම පාර යන වාහන වලට නිකන් ඇදිලා තියෙනවා. හරි මේක නිකන්. තත්කල් ලයිට්ස් නිකන්. පොලිස් කාර්ය නිකන්. පාලන් ටික නිකන්. ගෝකු ටික නිකන්. ඒ ටික ඔක්කොම නිකන් දීලා බවුසර් කාර්ය හරි බස් කාර්ය හරි ඔපරේට් කරන්නේ. ඒ දෙය ඔපරේටින් ෆස් ඩෝන්ට් හැව් එනි ඔෆ් දෝස්. එතකොට ඒ ටික අපි නිකන් වෙනව නේද ට්‍රාන්ස්පෝර්ට් ඔපරේටර්. රේල්වේ හරි ඉකොනොමික්ස් බලන්න නම් infrastructure part එක මේකෙන් separate කරලා ඒක RDA වගේ rail road development authority කියලා ප්‍රශ්න අහන්නේ නැති ලාභ පාඩු අහන්නේ නැති කිසි කෙනෙක් මේක ලාභ හොයන්නේ නැති ආයතන ඇතුළේ වෙනම account කරලා අන්න ඉතුරු ටික rail එක නැවොත් දැනටත් rail එක උඟක් හොදයි අවසාන ප්‍රශ්නේ අවසාන උත්තර economic viability බලන්න නැතුව සමහර projects වලට ආයෝජනය කරන්න බෑ මොකද ඒවා long gestation periods තියෙන national public infrastructure projects. ඒව බැලුවොත් එම අපිට වනජීවි ඒවා කරන්නත් බෑ, වනාන්තරවාදා කරන්නත් බෑ, ගංගා ද්‍රෝණි හදන්නත් බෑ, coast conservation කරන්නත් බෑ. ඒවයි gestation period සමහරවිට 200 300 years. දැන් මේවට financial විදිහට බලද්දී ඔයාලා invest කරන්න කිව්වොත් එම කවුරුත් invest කරන්නේ නැහැ. So whether you consider railway infrastructure the public investment for long infrastructure development or you want to make it as a kind of a revenue generating spinning thing has to be decided. I agree with you. There are so many areas where the revenue generation can be taken in. And that is what Professor Kumar very clearly said. We have to not only electrify the rail system, but the railway department also.
Right. Now, let's say, wait, hang on a second. Now, if I go by the planned event, we have reached the time. I would like to have a raise of hands if you are willing to stay and remain for another, shall we say, 30 minutes maximum. Huh? 15 minutes. Are you okay to remain for another 15 minutes? No, you have another question. Are you okay to remain another 15 minutes? Okay. So I'm going to get the question. Tony, you're going to get a question. You want to ask a question? Yes. Can you pass the mic to him, please? Since he was protesting and leaving. The mic, please. Now this time, let me tell you that this 15 minutes has to be used properly. Your question should be focused on electrification of railway, which is the topic, right? Please focus on that. Ask short, pointed question because I need about 2-3 minutes to do a vote of thanks and do the necessary duties. So let's go.
My name is Jayasundar. I am a
project
engineer and actually practicing in the UK and
Sir, you need to bring your mic right to your mouth.
Yes. Economical. Of course, if compared to the prices and all other things, I think it's very much poor price. Because of that, you will get social impact and environmental impact will also you have encountered in the job costing. So, of course, it will be less feasible. I believe, as I have seen railway, railway. Of course, I have seen in an article, one train has been running in the midnight. So, somewhere I have seen, I don't know whether.
Yeah, so let's take the question. What is your question, sir?
No. That is right. Railway people, so, actually, they have to have a proper consultant, consultancy. That means they may have very experienced consultant and proper equipment. They may have to use it. That's all.
Okay, thank you. Right, now you get your question, sir.
My question is, if we take Panandur to Veyamula, the coastal section is approximately end of Slave Island to Panandur. It is a very critical area. Therefore, to get the proper, required land, we have to fill a strip along the sea where majority of major places around 50 meters to 75 meters from the seashore. Right? The other thing is the port city development project going on. In 1972,
so
the sea erosion, right? This father was the chief engineer at the time. time.
So what's the question?
Question is, due to the port and city development work, any environmental erosion take place along this coastal section contributed to where this Panagura object considered. Thing is, need to do the hydrographical survey, geotechnical survey and the geological survey before start this coastal section.
Okay,
otherwise there will be bad effect from the Kalam Port City development project.
Okay, thank you. Question? Yes? We are a mechanical engineer from Morpho.
My first question is to
sir, bring it right next to your mouth.
Yes.
Right.
So my first question is, you mentioned that the existing railway needs to be railway track needs to be upgraded. So I would like to know a little bit more about the upgrades, like if dimensions be changed, what's the greatness going to be handled. Okay. And my second question is to Dr. Nura Naikaramis. I would like to know how the finance is handled, like who will be implementing the railway upgrades and how we are going to be back end, and like it will be the Ministry of Transport that will be taking that, and what will happen after, you know, the government changes, the ministerial portfolios also changes from time to time. And also like regarding the transport, like you mentioned that the interest rate will be 1.2%, I believe something like in that range. Will be based on foreign currency, like perhaps US dollars, so I'm going to say that US dollars as well. Thank you.
Good question.
Yeah, the answer to the question. Answer to the question is that upgrading means, you know, wherever the sleeper can be replaced, the sleeper can be replaced, it will remain to the popular sleeper. But suppose if they are back, they have to be replaced. Then the rail drive is wasted, so it can be replaced. If it's broken, it can be replaced. Then the basket system has to be checked. Then the balance cushion has to go up. And the rails will have to be welded right down. And each expansion drive can be put. That's the kind of upgrade that I think of. And then, of course, once it's already done, it should be okay for 100 km per hour.
Okay. Quick one, just a quick answer. I really don't know what the interest rate government is going to propose, but what I heard was, it was in the TV that Honorable Finance Minister had gone for a discussion with ADB, and they are willing to offer 1,000 million or something to government of Sri Lanka as concessional credit. And there it was mentioned it's 1.2, but it can be a little more. I mean, even if it is 2%, so what? 2% in dollar terms? True. I mean, what are we getting with the unsolicited proposals? Indian loans or Chinese loans or other things, what are we talking about? 3%, 4% plus, another 2.5 of that and 1.2 of that and this and the other. You get about 6-7% very easily. Those are all coming to commercial terms. So, if you are, now first decision is, we have now all agreed we need a railway electrification, priority, okay, decided. Then we need implementation. How to implement? We need money. Where are the sources? The cheapest source that we have, the most economical source we have, most advantageous source we have, most flexible source where we can modulate the project in our way and get the best technical consultants, get the best contractors, get the best method of implementation where maximization of local input can be brought in. Our project implementation and project carving out people are starting up. To structure the project that way. It is multilateral lending. So I would say this is a golden opportunity. The window is there. ADB is coming in. They are into invest. And we all want it. Let's go into that. Third question, whether it is Sri Lanka government railway which is going to do that, whether it is the Ministry of Transport. My viewpoint is there are things that the railway department can do. If it is railway department's job, the railway engineers are willing to. The railway engineers are kind of positive enough to take it up and do, let them do that. Because when you buy a kitchen and a cook, you don't eat outside. You eat outside while paying for a cook and the kitchen. It's waste of money. For me, either you eat outside or you have the cook and the kitchen, you prepare your food and eat. Right.
But then the second question is, there are certain things the railway department might not be able to do. Where you might have to get the external contractors, maybe local or international. My viewpoint is maximization of local value added, give the priority for local construction. There are a lot of local construction companies. If the railway cannot do it, get the local engineering skills and local construction companies, take it up and do it. And three, it is not possible, go international bidding and sourcing out maximum competition bidding. You may be not only getting one country's contractor, you get the right spectrum of the whole thing. And we are maximally getting benefit. What? How implementation after, post implementation operation is a strategic decision making has to be done by the Ministry of Transport. That will sit and work out how this operation is going to be. Maximum efficiency,
right?
Make up over the make a run.
Right, Dr. Thank you. Now, one last question I'm going to give. Harad,
Thank you.
Yes.
We are very hyped up about this thing, and we are very hopeful that it's going to happen. But the word of warning is what I want to give at this point in time. We are actually right. All of us know. So, what is the mechanism we have to make sure it does not get hijacked by the politician of whatever color? So, my comment is actually, we hope the steering committee, which will consist of professionals, will guard against that. And other one is, for us here in ISN, we have a role to play. Go out on the road even if necessary, take care of that, Mr.
Okay, thank you. Bala, just gave the opening for the last 4 minutes. Maybe last 4 minutes, huh? 1 minute, each one of you have 1 minute. Mahesh, where are you? Come to the front. You have 1 minute to, I'll do a little summary, 2 minute summary of my own. And then you think about what you're going to say in 1 minute. Think about the Parag's question. That's Parag Pujas, the fellow ASL. Think about that question. I would like to have 1 minute comment from all of you. This is what I think in the end of the day, this session, the summary, the reason we had this session, there will be many more if needed. The reason for this is there is a loan, very simple. I look at this very, very simple way. There is a very good loan from Asian Development Bank. At what, 1.2% or something like that, very small interest rate, right? We don't have money, that's a fact, that's a country, we don't have money for any type of capital investments. So we have a great interest coming from ADB, they will be not around for too long. Make use of it to do the electrification of a section of our railway system. By doing that, we will be able to show cases and as you said, sir, the country can look at what railway electrification is all about. It's a full comprehensive solution. So you have a showcase. Nothing to lose there, everything to gain. Now, important point that Gunwar was harping on, when you get a loan, it's like a loan you get from the bank. The bank doesn't tell you who's your basic bus should be. Bank doesn't tell you who's your engineer should be. It's up to you to figure it out. So one of the tremendous advantages in this approach is we as professionals, we as a country, we as politicians, authorities, we can decide exactly whom to bring to the party, right? This is the summary. Now, answer to Parag's question, what shall we do from now on? What should we do? Yeah.
Okay. Parag, ISN has got this long way. And now it's up to the institution and the Ministry of Transport to see that it is carried through. Because we have told about the importance of this project, when it is that it's going to the nation, and I don't think there is a task that it should stop here, because the steering committee is wrong, as you think. So, it is, of course, the steering committee, there are two of us are there at the moment, and when I spoke to the secretary, the steering committee will go on. So, there is a very good chance that the secretary too will support us. And I don't think there's a way that it will get delayed, and I hope not. And as you say, we are a big goal here, in of engineers. There are both of the corporate members, and we can, and because he said he's an engineer, and therefore we have all the power behind us with the government hierarchy, and then the system will go on.
Thank you. Good day. What you have to say? 1 minute.
Throughout the history, we have been engineers and developers. 2500 years ago, we did marvels. Okay? And let's first have the self-confidence that we can do it. Number one. So let's have it. We can do it. What we have got to figure out now is how to do it, that's all. Okay? Hats off to Arjuna. Because of him and his drive, today we have this rising up of the professionals. Professionals rising up out of the day and for the occasion is prime importance at this level. You made a very valid point that we should stand up and follow this and push this until the last moment and the first train is electric train is on the track, so that we have to do it. Professionals raising up and standing up for their rights, for national economy, national development, and also to protect the professionals, engineers, own profession. It was a necessity yesterday. Just like railway electrification yesterday, it was a necessity yesterday. So I'm happy that it happened today, and thanks to Arjun. Thank you.
Mr. Jaisinghan, short of holding placards and going to Port Railway Station, the Institution of Engineers has done so much to keep this project in focus. So what is required now is to have the determination that it will be done. There is no question whether it will be done or how it will be done, it will be done. The greatest thing we have is that finances are available. True, when you look at it from a traditional railway engineer's mindset, 300 million into 140, it's a huge amount of money. Anybody would say, why are you spending so much of money? Give me 10 locomotives, I can improve the service. Right? So that, I would say, is a requirement. But here we are talking about, I would not like to call it a revolution, but a very significant investment in the railway sector, which the sector has never had. I don't think the sector has ever had a $300 million investment in one go or in several tranches. So therefore, the requirement of the official side to make sure that this remains on track is to implement fully the government decisions that have been taken quite some time ago. So now we spoke of a steering committee. The steering committee was activated in July last year. The last meeting was in September last year. Since September last year, the Ministry of Transport has not called the steering committee. I am a member of the steering committee on behalf of IESL. So, the Ministry of Transport and Sri Lanka Railways, now that we all agree that the project will be done, has to be done, has to take the steering committee and its external members, not only us. You know, the electricity board is there, LECO is there, who have a lot of resources at their command if the project needs startup support. So that support is forthcoming. At one core of the CEP said, I think they will build a substation free of charge for Sri Lanka Railways. So even that kind of very quick support is available from the other stakeholders. So it is up to the Ministry of Transport and the Sri Lanka Railways to use that support that is available and deliver this project. Everybody is waiting.
I believe the country's development rests solely on the quality of the professional advice given by its officials and how decision makers receive them or not. Countries that have done that have prospered. Countries that have done that, not done that, have suffered. I need not tell Sri Lanka's recent history as to whether professionals gave the correct advice, whether politicians sought the correct advice. I will not go into that. If you look at some of the infrastructure, particularly transport infrastructure, road, rail, airports, ports, I think the fact that we have huge debts to pay and very little use economic or financial of them tells the story of whether professionals gave the correct advice and whether government sought the correct advice. And I believe this is time, Mr. Chairman, that ISL needs to reestablish its dominance, its prerogative
in advising government as the leading professional technical institution in the country. And I thank you personally for arranging this platform, this forum, to ensure IAS services. So here is a project for professionals to not just agree, but to debate, discuss, but make sure that the project goes on as a professionally driven project with the necessary political help and not the other way. Thank you very much. And I would like to recognize our president, engineer Gamage is here. Now all of you know that he travels from Kandy to Kathambu on a public transport, but he's here and our past president is here, Manjit Munawadan is here. So all these people are here. Big gathering, so that shows Amal and the team colleagues the support we have from the IESL. And in this group, I know the faces you may not know, there are a different kind of group of people here as well. So whatever it takes to get the job done, they are here. So we have brought this subject up because we believe this is a national need. We got to do these kind of things, and so there are various ways to get things done. So Para, you can be rest assured, we will push this forward. With that, I would like to ask Mahesh, one of my committee members, our committee members, to come and give a vote of thanks, please. And he has been with me all the way. By the way, there are a lot of newspaper articles. I think about 8 newspapers published articles, English, Sinhala, and Tamil, in the last few days. And hopefully, the TV group might say something. I think Guruwan made sure that they will say something. You are something. That's all they have put there. Mahesh, please.
Thank you, Sanjay. Mr. President of ASL, Engineer Chen Gamge, Secretary of Minister of Transport, Engineer Sumedha, and other representative from government authorities, and our ISL past president and other ASL members who are here, and our MESC Chairman, Engineer Arjun Manampay, and our resource person of this session. Other distinguished invitees, friends from media, my dear sir, madams, and friends. I am Mahesh Dharmasena, representing the Engineering Section Committee. It gives me great pleasure to propose the vote of thanks on behalf of our committee of the ISL. First and foremost, I would like to express my sincere gratitude on behalf of MESC to our panel members. Today's discussion, Dr. Tilak Singhalapitiya, Professor Amal S. Kumarge, Dr. Lakshari Gunaruan, and Engineer Payal Sinha, for their invaluable contribution for this fruitful session. Communications happen among us for the initial preparation, and the way that it has been executed shows us the true professional interest and dedication of you to take Sri Lankan railway system to its next level. You are the leading professional to create interest among the public on railway electrification and modernization project and right people to convince the authorities to implement it. We trust that this session would have contributed a lot of to make it happen. Thanks again for all your hard work. Electrification of railway system was discussed way back in 1924 and now becoming a reality as proposal made by ISL in 2008 has reached to a certain level of nearly implementation. Railway electrification project has granted highest priority in Western Region Megapolis project. A steering committee to study the proposal has been appointed. Capital has already been secured and strategies and project management has been established. Therefore, it needs only the implementation by the authority. So, economic benefits and trouble-free public transportation that has been discussed during this session should be spread among the public and required stimulation should be given to authority to implement it immediately. We trust that our media friends who are here right now and the enthusiastic crowd as you will take the leading role to take this message to the public. By the way, I'm also a railway child. My father and mother worked in railway, so I'm delighted to see the railways going to develop.
transportation is part of mechanical engineering section committee, overreaching tie aim for economic development of our country. Therefore, we took initiative to take the leadership to create the public awareness of countries their need towards the development. So I must thank our leader, Ajna Manapel, chairman of MESC, for this initiation and utmost contribution to make this event happen. Thanks again for making the session really interesting by moderating it splendidly. Support extended by ISL staff, my MESC colleagues is immense, and I would like to take this opportunity to thank the master. Last but not least, we MESC would like to thank all the participants, including ISL president, ISL chairman, and past president, representative from government authorities, media persons, ISL members, people representing other professions, and enthusiastic public for taking part of this session. As a token of appreciation, I would like to invite President of
you first come. We to ask both of them. You come one at a time. before we give the token of appreciation, I would like to do a big round of applause to this young man, Shamara, who is being here every day.
Right. So I'd like to invite our president to come forward and hand over the comment. First, I would like to invite Dr. Priya Singh.
Thank you, Dilak.
Next, Professor Amar Kumar.
Thank you very much.